Hello, everybody. This is Pastor McGuire again, continuing our study of the Gospel of Mark. We are in Mark chapter 3, and we're going to pick up where we left off, discussing those verses having to do with Jesus calling the 12. But first, let's go to the Lord in prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, without your help, all our efforts are useless, and without your guidance, all our searches are in vain. Invigorate our study of your holy word by your Holy Spirit, so that by your word our faith in your Son Jesus might be strengthened and we might be transformed in our hearts and our minds to live a life of service to our neighbor. And in Jesus' blessed name we pray. Amen. All right, as I said, we're in Mark chapter 3, and we left off talking about verse 13. Where it says that Jesus himself chose the apostles, that he summoned those whom he himself desired to summon or desired to call to himself. And that's no small thing, that the emphasis is on Jesus' initiative, that Jesus is the one calling the disciples, not the disciples seeking him. And we have here in Christ the incarnation of the seeking God. Remember how in John, the Gospel of John, when Jesus has that conversation with the Samaritan woman at the well, and he says that one day you'll worship neither at Mount Gerizim or at Mount Sinai, Mount Zion, you'll instead worship in spirit and truth, because worshippers in spirit and truth are the kind that God is seeking. God is seeking those to worship him. And so we see Jesus everywhere seeking the lost. He's the one that takes it upon himself to find those to save. But then he also, in this sense, calls those he's saved to serve him in a special way. And we can definitely apply the call of the apostles to our own salvation, that we cannot by our own reason or strength believe in Jesus Christ our Lord or come to him, but the Holy Spirit has called us by the gospel, enlightened us with his gifts. The initiative is completely God's in our salvation. And what a comfort that is, to know that it is no accident. It wasn't somehow left to us to find God. God did the finding. And if our being saved rests with God finding us, then that's for sure. That we can have confidence in a way we can't if it was left to us seeking God out. We know because of our sin, we would never do that purely, perfectly. Certainly would not remain in that position on our own, but God not only calls us, but keeps us with him by the work of the gospel. And then it says they went out toward him, or went out to him, and he appointed 12. Why 12? Well, I think many of you in the audience are going to say, duh, 12 tribes of Israel. But let's connect the dots a little bit more. If you looked at the last few chapters of the book of Isaiah, especially that section of Isaiah that gives us those wonderful servant songs, which are all a picture of Christ ahead of time, who is the servant of the Lord, come to carry out God's purpose of saving and restoring his world. And maybe most memorably of all those servant songs, the suffering servant song, which we want to return to in a few minutes. But I pointed out several sections of Isaiah there that speak specifically of the restoration of Israel. And if you were to look, for example, at Isaiah 49 verse 6, it's too light a thing, God speaking to his servant, the servant of the Lord. It's too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to bring back the preserved of Israel. Hear that? The tribes of Jacob. To bring back the tribes of Jacob is a signal that the restoration of Israel is beginning. But he goes on to say, I will make you as a light for the nations, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth. So a couple of things here that Jesus is appointing 12 is another strong indication of Jesus as the one come to restore. We saw that with the restoration, literally, of the man with the withered hand. Not just that it was healed, but that it was restored. It was put back in the position that God originally intended his creation to be in. But now he's restoring Israel. Those grand, magnificent promises at the end of Isaiah are starting to come true in the ministry of Jesus Christ. But if that's the case, if the appointing of the 12 is the inauguration of that restoration of Israel, that means that it's also the beginning of the restoration of the whole world, because these things are lined up with not just Israel's being made right again, being brought back, but that salvation reaching the ends of the earth. Even the Gentiles are going to benefit from this one in whom the kingdom of God is personified. He, in a sense, is the kingdom of God. When you see Jesus, the rule and reign of God has manifest himself. So that's, I think, the most important thing to be said about his having 12. Why that number? And there it is. There's another interesting promise connected with this. If you were to go to Matthew chapter 19 and verse 28. Yes. So context here, rich young man has left his conversation with Jesus sorrowful because Jesus has told him that if he were to be perfect, he ought to give up everything he has, sell it to the poor, and then follow him. And the man's riches were too important to him for him to do this. And so Peter turns around and says, "Hey, Jesus, look at all the stuff we've given up. What are we going to get?" And Jesus kind of pulls the rug out from under Peter and shows him what a no-brainer it is to follow Jesus. And that don't think so highly of your own motives when you're going to be more than compensated for whatever little you sacrificed to be his disciple. So he says, "Hey, we've left everything and followed you. What then will we have?" And Jesus says in verse 28, "Truly I say to you, in the new world, when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." Isn't that interesting? So the apostles, in some way, are going to occupy a higher position even than the patriarchs of the Old Testament, because they will sit in judgment, in a place of authority. And this, I think, is of a piece with the point that the 12 represent Israel being brought back, Israel being restored through Christ. And then, whom he also named apostles. I want to say a quick word here. I've done this before in many classes because apostle is such an important word in the New Testament. The church is built on the testimony of the apostles. What does that word mean? Well, this is one of those Greek words where we've got a noun whose meaning really depends on the verb from which it's formed. And the verb, in fact, shows up in this same verse. You look at the kind of the middle where it says that they might be with him and in order that he might send them out to preach. But that sending them out, that's the verb, apostello, from which the noun apostle comes. What does this mean? In brief, it's almost a technical word meaning having to do with someone in authority, a king, a magistrate, sending an ambassador to represent him in some activity of state in such a way that that ambassador has plenipotentiary authority. That is to say, whatever the ambassador representing the king says is as good as if the king himself said it. That's what this sending outward is connected with and entails. So, what's going on? Jesus is doing this with the 12. He is going to send them out as his ambassadors on a particular mission in such a way that they have authority to speak as though you are hearing it directly from Jesus himself. That's what it means to be an apostle. It's more than a disciple is a believer in Christ, but now of that group of believers, followers, students, Jesus is appointing these special apostles who are going to have authority to do special things, and that's very specifically outlined in the clauses that follow in this verse. Let's look at those. What does it say? It says, in order that they might be with him, we might say, here's purpose number one for sending them out, or calling them to be apostles, that they might be with him, number one. Number two, that he might send them out to preach, and that he might send them out to have authority to cast out demons. And I've got a wonderful excerpt from a commentary by a man named Cranfield, who put this very well, and I want to just read that to you. He says this: first, they were to be with him. They had to learn from him before they could be sent out by him, to hear before they could speak for him. And that is such an important point to be made, and I think has relevance for us as Christians who are called to give a reason for the hope that is within us. When asked, we are Jesus' ambassadors in that way, and then specifically pastors have another kind of official calling to speak for Jesus, for the community of believers on Jesus' behalf. But it all starts with being with Jesus. I think we so often hear words like follow me, come follow me from Jesus, and we hear that word follow in the way we hear the word follow in the game, follow the leader, and follow meaning imitate me. Whatever I do, do the same. And it may have that sense secondarily, but I think first and foremost it simply means follower. Follow Jesus, watch what he does, listen to what he says. And only after a period of doing that can the apostles then faithfully follow him in that second kind of way. And certainly only after they've listened and literally followed him, watched him, observed, can they then speak for him and act on his behalf or in his behalf. And so it is for us Christians in general, that we can only serve as encouragement and salt and light in the lives of those God has given us if we have first spent time with him. I think we pastors especially need to be reminded of this, that we're called upon to speak, to give out, to produce so much for the body of Christ and for the neighborhood and the community and evangelize and so forth. But if all you do is exhale, eventually you're going to hyperventilate. You've got to inhale just as much, if not more, than you've got to breathe in more than you breathe out, or else the breathing out will be toxic, to use that analogy. That we've got to be with Jesus before we can speak for him. And so to stay in the Word, to gather together as opportunities are given us to gather together and study the Word together, to study the Word at home, alone, with the family. Let Jesus speak to us before we then speak to others on his behalf. Secondly, he would give them a mission which itself was twofold, to preach and to have authority to cast out the demons. And Cranfield goes on to say that this sending them out to preach has to do not only with the preaching that they would do before Jesus went to the cross, and we'll see that later in Mark, the sending of the disciples out from village to village to preach the gospel, but maybe more importantly, the preaching they would do after the resurrection, that Peter would stand up on Pentecost and boldly proclaim Jesus of Nazareth as the Son of God who has been raised from the dead, that we might have life through him, that preaching, which then is inscripturated, the apostles' preaching is in written form what we call the New Testament. And so here is the authority that we treat the New Testament with, that Jesus would call the apostles to send them out to preach. And then finally, and Cranfield doesn't talk about this as much, he talks more about the preaching part, but let's not also leave out that they're going to have authority to cast out demons. And what's the significance there? That our biggest problem is a spiritual one, not a physical one. Our enemies are ultimately spiritual forces, not physical forces. As Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers in the air, right? The powers of darkness. What's he talking about? The devil and his demons and all those instruments that the devil uses in this sinful world to separate us from Christ, to menace our faith, to claim us for hell. That's the significance, that of all the things Jesus could commission his disciples to have, that they have this authority tells us, aha, here's where the real battle's being fought. It's on in the spiritual dimension, not just the earthly dimension or the physical dimension. Okay, want to run through this. He goes through and now is going to name the 12, or we're given the name of the 12. Simon, now called Peter, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, are going to be called the sons of thunder. And the very fact that he gives them an extra name, adds a name to them, reminds us of figures in the Old Testament such as Abram, who becomes Abraham, or Sarai, who becomes Sarah, or Jacob, who becomes Israel. Even in the book of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, those are their Babylonian names. They're added a name, and those names also have significance. But one of the things those namings have in common is with the name comes a new position, and a new position that brings with it a certain authority. Abraham in Isaiah is going to literally be called the Rock of Israel. Peter now, Simon, is now the Rock, or we might say Rocky. But why might that be? Well, Peter is going to have or exercise a kind of more prominent role among the 12. He's no more an apostle than anybody else, and yet we see him over and over again take on a kind of leadership position among them. He speaks on their behalf so often, and he's the one that stands up and preaches at Pentecost. He's the one that is the great influencer at the council at Jerusalem in Acts chapter 15, whose telling of his experience with Cornelius sways the early church in their decision as to how to deal with Gentile converts, etc., etc. Another question you might ask is, okay, we have 12 apostles, why do only three of them get new names? And that may have to do with the fact that in the Old Testament, the truth of anything was to be attested by two or three witnesses. And so these are, of the 12, the three that Jesus, you know, in certain instances, is going to rely on exclusively to be his witnesses. We remember that it's Peter, James, and John only, not the other nine, just Peter, James, and John, who get to go up with Jesus to the Mount of Transfiguration. It's only Peter, James, and John who get to witness Jesus' raising of Jairus' daughter and a few others like that. But it is interesting, isn't it, that only three of the 12 get new names, and it may have something to do with that. I've prepared for you as a handout that I've attached as a separate attachment, the parallel lists of the apostles' names in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And what I've done is, in the left column, I've given you the order in which Mark gives you their names, and then I'm showing you their parallel names in the Matthew and Luke columns, but in such a way that the number in front of the name is the number that name appears in that particular gospel writer's list. So, for example, Andrew shows up fourth in Mark's list, but he's second in both Matthew and Luke's list. And it is funny, isn't it, that Andrew, Mark himself, has Andrew as one of the first two disciples called by Jesus when he was out there on the Sea of Galilee and sees them out fishing. And yet he's demoted, it seems, to fourth place here in chapter 3. But Matthew and Luke keep him right there next to Peter. It's Peter and Andrew in their list. But you're going to see that as you compare those lists, that there's a slight variation in the names, and maybe the biggest one is with Thaddeus, who in Luke's list is going to be referred to as Judas the son of James. So you've potentially got two Judases, one the son of James, one Iscariot, but that is likely the same person known as Thaddeus in Mark and Matthew's list. And I think that's it. Bartholomew, I believe, is referred to as Nathan in the book of Acts. And what else? Matthew, of course, we've been introduced to, presumably already, in Mark chapter 2. But there he's referred to as Levi, the tax collector. But he's Matthew and Mark. He's Matthew, the tax collector, in the Gospel of Matthew. But here's an interesting point. That is that this Levi in chapter 2 is the son of Alphaeus. And then we get later James, the son of Alphaeus. Could they be brothers? You assume it's the same Alphaeus. And if they're both sons of Alphaeus, that makes Matthew and this other James, the son of Alphaeus, brothers. Okay, that is enough about the names. I won't belabor that, though there's a lot of interesting things that could be said about each of them. But let's just do this. Let's go to the very last disciple, or last apostle, I should say, mentioned, and that is Judas. Judas Iscariot, and that Iscariot part is most likely his place of origin. He's from a village called Kerioth, K-E-R-I-O-T-H. So Judas Iscariot is a way of saying the Judas from that town called Kerioth. It was a village about 12 miles south of Hebron. But then it says, who also betrayed him, or literally, who also handed him over. That ought to ring bells for us, because back in Mark chapter 1, verse 14, what do we have? After the, in your translations, arrest, but it's literally the handing over of John. The handing over of John. And now that same verb here is being used of Judas, who is going to hand Jesus over. Several things to be said here, and I'll go maybe in order of increasing order of importance. First, that it's put exactly this way, that we've got the handing over verb, just as we did in the case of John, signals to us that Mark's readership knows the story already. Right, so Mark is not writing this gospel so as to tell people for the first time the facts and significance and meaning of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. They know it already. There's some other purpose at work. He's strengthening the faith of those who already believe, not intending necessarily to bring people who don't yet believe to faith. Otherwise, this kind of comes out of nowhere. Judas, who betrayed him, or it's certainly a huge spoiler, isn't it, if you're reading this for the first time? No, Mark's hearers, Mark's original audience knew this already. The second thing, though, is that because we've got the handing over word, just as we did with John, it's making an important connection between John's life and Jesus. That we've already seen John handed over, and now, lo and behold, the one that John was the forerunner of, the one that John heralded, the one that John said, one mightier than I, the laces of whose thongs I'm unworthy to untie, is coming, that if he was handed over, not surprisingly, the one that he promised was coming after him will also suffer the same fate. Or you can look at it the other way around, that we know Jesus is handed over. No wonder his closest followers and his most prominent, conspicuous messengers also suffered being betrayed and handed over. That kind of thing. And we're going to see that point being made, I think, even more forcefully in a later chapter when the apostles are sent out to preach. And in the middle of that, sending and the coming back after having been sent, we're going to get the account of John's beheading by Herod. Okay, but then the most important thing about this, I think, is this. We're going to see this handing over word again. Jesus is going to predict his passion using this word, that he's going to be handed over to the Gentiles. And that he's going to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. That this word is picking up on one of the great prophecies in the suffering servant chapter of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 53. And if you look at Isaiah 53 verse 6 and Isaiah 53 verse 12, I'm going to put those up on the screen here for you to see. You're going to see that in the Septuagint translation, that is the Greek translation of the Hebrew Old Testament, our wording is a little different from what you may be used to because you're used to the translation into English from the Hebrew. But look at this. Look at what it says about the suffering servant, that the Lord handed him over for our sins. It's the exact same verb in Greek as the verb here that is used to describe Judas's betraying him. The Lord handed him over for our sins. And then in verse 12, his soul or life was handed over unto death. And on account of their sins, he was handed over. So three times in those two verses, we have this exact word for being betrayed or being handed over, and being said of whom? The suffering servant, the one by whose stripes we are healed, the one by whom our transgressions are forgiven. You know, all we like sheep have gone astray, but he laid on him the iniquity of us all. That verse in the Septuagint is all we like sheep have gone astray. Each has gone his own way. That's pretty much the Greek part, the Greek way of reading that too. But then the next part, he laid on him the iniquity of us all, that instead is the Lord handed him over for our sins, for our iniquities. Huh. Isn't that interesting? So Mark is having us make that connection. That in the midst of this restoration of Israel, we have this note of that restoration entailing the sacrifice of the one who brings the kingdom, the handing over of the Messiah. Okay, that's, I think, enough for this section of Mark, and we'll move on to the next verses, which will round out chapter 3 next time. But until then, let's close in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, which reveals to us your loving heart and unfolds for us your great plan of salvation, which you were so faithful to execute and carry out to its completion by sending your own Son and giving him up for us on the cross. We thank you, Lord, for showing to us how you have restored not only Israel, but the whole world through the life and death, resurrection, and ascension of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we know this already by faith and await its perfect consummation on the day our Lord comes again in glory. And until then, grant us patience and trust until you grant us that fulfilled promise of life with you in the new heaven and the new earth. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.